So I'd like to go into biological phosphorus removal, but before I go there, I'd just like to mention the idea of there's always a possibility of using chemicals. Now, it so happens, there was, I showed you that picture in the Johannesburg area, and there was so much indirect reuse taking place already that salinity of the water was increasing during drought periods to above the levels that's safe or recommended by the World Health Organization. So this was not an option for us, but you can add chemicals to the activated sludge plant. It will precipitate the phosphorus and you can get the phosphorus down to quite low levels. The problem is just the lower you go, the more chemicals you have to add. This produces a lot of chemical sludge, and it may require the additional of alkalinity because you're nitrifying at the same time, you're adding chemicals that reduce the alkalinity. And it's difficult if you want to reclaim that phosphorus because now it's tied up permanently, and the many plants are moving away from it, and as I said, it adds salinity. So we came to biological phosphorus removal, and over the years, there's been a perception, and I think mostly because people didn't quite understand the process very well, calling it, it's an unreliable process. And I overheard Professor Hermos, who was a very famous Danish professor, and a good friend of mine, I heard him saying to somebody else, he said, biological phosphorus removal is something you design for, hope for, and add chemicals if it doesn't work. But this guy here, at a paper, he said, biological phosphorus removal is notoriously unreliable. And Cliff Randall was standing next to me from Virginia Tech, and I said, this guy is remarkably, notoriously ignorant. He says something like that. So what is biological phosphorus removal? It is just conditioning organisms, and we have found organisms that will take up surplus phosphorus much, much more than their bodily needs. And if we can get them to grow, then we can remove them, and with them, and remove the phosphorus too. And so what we need is an anaerobic stage and an aeration stage, and I'll come to explain why that is necessary. But to really understand what happened, let's begin at the beginning. And this is the first proposal for biological phosphorus removal, and this was called the faux strip process. And this, nobody understood the mechanism at the time. Nobody really studied those the organisms that would do that. And so what they said is, well, let's take this return sludge, the sludge that we returned from the settling tank, put it through a deep anaerobic stage and strip that phosphate off. That phosphate will be released under those conditions. That we knew. And they published their theory is that we strip that phosphate off, the bacteria will be so hungry for more phosphate, so they go around and take up all the phosphorus that's in the influent. In the meantime, we take that, this is like a settling tank, and take that high concentration of phosphate and treat it with lime. But what we found is even if we did not do that, it would remove phosphorus. So, but the main thing here is that the retention time in there was 30 to 40 hours in the stripper. And the other thing is that the influent wastewater didn't go in there, it went into the aeration basin. Now, the significance of that I'll come to in a minute. It's all a little bit intertwined. Now, that plant did not nitrify, it was just a plant that was designed such that the SRT was low enough that it would wash out the nitrifiers. And then many, many plants were designed like that because at that time it was cheaper because if you don't need to nitrify, then you don't use that energy. You don't need to put that energy in to get the ammonia to nitrates. In this plant here, It's that four stage that I just referred to earlier. I did it in the lab, the four stage nitrification, denitrification, and I got like 92% reduction of the nitrogen in the influent. So then I tried this, and this basin was available, and I put in these four zones that you can see here. But in order to space the zones correctly, I had this, what I call dead zone, onto, and I show it here diagrammatically like that. And in between these, I had 2 1-inch holes just to make sure that the pressure was on the same on both sides. So I had that anoxic zone there, this aerobic zone here, and then it would flow into the second anoxic zone and the re-aeration zone. And so I decided to look at what happened to the phosphorus in this plant. And to my astonishment, they reported there was no phosphorus coming out of it. Well, it was less than 0.2. They didn't measure below 0.2. It was coming in at about 9 or 10 milligram per liter. What is interesting, again, that the primary influent went into the anoxic zone. And what I found 9 years later, after I've been wondering about this, because I tried it in the lab to do the same. I jumped myself a little here. What I did is when I did a profile through here, I noticed that the phosphate coming in at 9 was going to about 8 in the anoxic zone, then 7, and then greater than 30, and then it was taken up to almost nothing. And this really interested me, because that's the same thing that happened in other plants where they accidentally saw phosphorus removal. So I suggested that what is necessary is for the sludge to pass through a deep anaerobic condition where the phosphate will be released. And when you do that, you trigger these phosphate accumulating organisms. But I didn't understand the mechanism. But this was enough to make the plants in Johannesburg area, because of the, as I said, we couldn't add chemicals for phosphorus removal. So this was immediately accepted and built into the plants, even just from the lab scale, because they did some tests themselves. And that really made this progress going from a lab scale unit to a full scale. The first plant that Johannesburg built was about a 750,000 population equivalent plant. And they added this in because they felt that the cost of adding it in at the time when the plant was built was just a lot cheaper than having to spend the money on chemicals. Anyway, being frustrated because I couldn't repeat this in the lab, I suggested that if an anaerobic zone is needed, why not add that anaerobic zone up front there and use the primary effluent to create those anaerobic conditions? And I suggested in these flow sheets here, these flow sheets I called photodox because it was phosphate removal by lowering the redox potential by getting it anaerobic. And that was copied by Air Products and patented in the US as the AO and A2O process. And the other side of the story, it was actually all wrong. I'll come back to that. But the point is, it worked. This was the first plant in Palmetto. We put in this anaerobic zone there, Palmetto, Florida, and the total nitrogen was 3, total phosphorus was less than 1 milligram per liter, starting from about 5. Fusen Chen studied the Foster process, and they came up with a theory. And this was the first comprehensive theory as to what really happens in this plant. Now you see an aerobic stage and an anaerobic stage and a recycle taking place in there, like I had in that first sketch. So what they said is that phosphate, polyphosphate in organisms, like in our own body, that is our source of energy. We form these phosphate bonds, high energy phosphate bonds, and we break the bonds when we need to reuse that energy, the same with the bacteria. And these organisms can accumulate a lot of this polyphosphate And then you pass them back to the anaerobic zone, and now they break up that polyphosphate, release the phosphate, and that's why we saw the phosphate release. And they take up volatile fatty acids in a form of acetic and propionic acid. Now, fortunately, in most plants, in the sewer system, that fermentation is taking place, and we produce acetic and propionic acid as the lowest form of fermentation. And that's sort of like in slime layers, especially when you have pump stations pumping wastewater, you get that breakdown in the slime layers and reproduce those volatile fatty acids. So they take up those volatile fatty acids, store it as an intermediate product because they're actually strictly aerobes. And they cannot live under anaerobic conditions, but then you pass them to an aerobic condition, and they now use the oxygen to consume that food and produce the energy to again refill their pool, and so they take up the phosphorus that they released and all the phosphorus in the influent down to quite low levels. And this mechanism was proposed by Fusen Chen and further developed by Kumo and Bensel. So here we see that volatile fatty acids, the problem is that especially in colder climates, there's not enough volatile fatty acids in the influent to do this. But so fortunately, in the anaerobic zone, readily biodegradable COD will also be fermented to volatile fatty acids. And that's why we have to have a zone where there's no nitrates or oxygen. If we have that, then we can see this happen. But even then, it may not be enough, and we may even have to put in a source of volatile fatty acids from outside. Now, that comes back to what I said earlier about people didn't understand the process. If you didn't have enough of this volatile fatty acids, you have to add some. And I'll show you in a minute how we did that. And if you don't add it, then the process is unreliable. And I always compare it to somebody that says, I get, say, 25 miles on a gallon. So I put in 2 gallons and I want to drive 100 miles. The car runs out of gas. So is the car unreliable or am I just stupid? And this is basically what that comes to. But this is a proof of the electron microscope where you see the intermediate products that they save in the anaerobic zone stains white here, and the poly P stains black. And you can see these organisms, the massive amount of poly P that they can accumulate. So when we waste them out of the system, then phosphate goes along with them. And that's how we get it out of the system.